Today we are here to discuss about the basics of electrocardiography. The ECG is very important for the cardiology because in spite of we have been increasing our diagnostic technique so much and so sophisticated technology has been available right now, but the first and foremost technology wherever we go and whatever we do, the first thing we do always is electrocardiography, that is ECG. So it is very much important all of us should know and learn how to read and how to take this and interpretation of this electrocardiography. So not wasting too much time, I request Dr. Rajnish Shardana to take this session.
Coming to the topic straight away, the basics of ECG. So it's going to be, what is an ECG, what are the basic principles of ECG, what is the nomenclature, and then we go ahead with the evaluation, the most important part. So what is an ECG? ECG, or some people call it EKG, it's a fashion to call it EKG. ECG is a measurement of subtotal of electrical activity generated by the heart and is measured from the surface of the body. In other words, it's an electrical record of the heart's activity. It remains one of the most valuable diagnostic tools for recognition of various variety of cardiac disorders. So as you see it in this diagram, we have an electromagnetic field and it's being recorded from the surface, and we've got various equipment which using the amplifier and the recorder we come out with the trace. Before we move ahead, I think it's very important to understand the conduction system of the heart. The four chambers, as you can see in the diagram, on the top of it we have the sinoatrial node, which is the basic starter or the pacemaker of the heart, where the activity, electrical activity initiates. From there it travels through the specialized muscles, through the specialized conduction system to the atria, and then down to the ventricle through the AV node. Through the AV node goes down to the two bundle, the bundle of Hayes, followed by the left and the right bundle, and the left bundle divides into the anterior fascicle and the posterior fascicle. So we've got this conduction system, and not to forget the muscle is the remaining conduit for the conduction. The difference between the two is important. Anything which goes through these fibers or the specialized tissues, it's a very fast conduction, whereas anything which is spread through the muscle is a relatively slower conduction. So whenever we have the conduction, specialized conduction system, you will have a very narrow or a skinny ECG pattern, whereas anything which spreads through the muscle is going to be much broader and wider. The use of an ECG, of the most useful tool for diagnosing cardiac problems, including the rate and the rhythm problems, the tissue damage due to ischemia and infarction, and helps localizing the area of the damage, also theoretically indicating towards the vessel which might be involved, the effects of drugs and electrolyte imbalances. It's a easy tool to diagnose, especially conditions like hyperkalemia, hypertrophy and dilatation, chamber hypertrophy, which help us corroborate various valvular disease, congenital disease, and some electrophysiological abnormalities and therapies like the Wolff-Parkinson and the Brugada syndromes. To start with the the recording system or the lead systems, you can have the ECG being recorded from the limbs of the body. So you can have a ECG being recorded between the right and the left arms, which is designated as the lead one. You can have the recording between the right arm and the left leg, which is designated the lead two. And we have the recordings between the left arm and the left foot, which is called the lead three. One, two, and three are usually called the standard leads. And arbitrarily, they have been designated a positive and a negative pole. So in the lead one, the left arm serves as the positive and the right as the negative. In the foot, we have the positive for lead two as well as three. The way I try and remember is that anything on the left is positive. So the foot is positive in both. And when you have a choice on the lead one, the left is positive and the right is negative. Sometimes it's confusing, but I remember, try and remember that the foot is always positive. And on the left side, in the lead one, the left arm is positive. Then we have the next system, which is the augmented leads. The difference here is that we are trying to record a potential between a central neutral point and a particular limb, whereas in the previous one we were trying to record the difference between the two leads. So these are called unipolar recordings or augmented leads. What we have here is a recording between a central terminal of Wilson or and a particular limb. When it is recording the right arm potential, it is called the AVR, A for the augmented, V for the neutral point, and R for the right arm. On the left arm, it is called the AVL, and on the foot, it is called the left foot, it is the AVF. Putting these two together, we have a system, and the triangle of Ethoven, which was described as hypothesized as the lead 1, 2, and 3 forming an equilateral triangle with the center being the heart in this case. So as you see, we have the lead systems, these augmented and the standard leads form 6 leads, and then you combine them with the chest leads, we form a 12 lead ECG. What we sometimes come across and everybody requests, can you get me a 12 lead ECG? All it means is the standard 3 leads, the augmented leads, and the chest leads. For people who are keen to understand the position on where we're going to focus or put the leads, lead V1 is put on the right side of the sternum in the fourth intercostal space, V2 on the left side in the fourth intercostal space, V4 in the fifth intercostal space in the midclavicular line, lead V3 is the position between V2 and V4, V5 and V6 are in the same line as V4 but in the anterior axillary line and the mid axillary line. So you've got 6 chest leads which are the unipolar leads. So we've got bipolar leads which are 1, 2 and 3, then we've got unipolar leads which are augmented leads of the L, AVL, AVR, AVF, and the chest leads, these are all unipolar leads. The difference between bipolar and unipolar is that bipolar is between two parts of the body or between two poles, whereas unipolar is a pure potential between a neutral point and that particular area. So just to revise again, so lead 1 here is between the right arm and the left arm, lead 2 is between the right arm and the left leg, lead 3 is between the left arm and the left leg, the augmented is between the arm or the leg and the neutral, which can be formed by joining the other two, the remaining limbs here, with a resistance in between to bring that potential to zero. So you are measuring it against probably a zero potential. As you can see, in this is the AVR, AVL, AVF. These will be important when we come and understand the axis of the heart. There is also an ECG being shown here in each one of them. This is important, and when we talk about the genesis of ECG, you will understand what sort of an electrogram we get in these leads and why it's so different. The basics of ECG or understanding of where it is generated, I think the core is formed by the depolarization wavefront. You've got the pacemaker cells in the sinoatrial node, which start a depolarization wavefront which travels in a particular direction. And it's a cell-to-cell propagation where we've got the positive pole, which is the exterior or the interior. The cell membrane is about minus 90 millivolt negative to begin with. When it depolarizes, there's an influx of the sodium channels or the sodium into the cell, which makes it positive. So we've got a potential wavefront which is moving, and depending on where you're recording from, you'll either get a positive or a negative deflection. And to understand it better here, we've got the cells here. So if you have the electrical activity going in a particular direction, you can be recording from any point, and when you record it from a particular point in the body, as you see in this, we have an electrical wavefront or a depolarization wavefront moving from left to right. So if you've got a lead recording it from here, it's going to record a positive. So anything which is moving towards the recording electrode will be recorded as a positive. Vis-a-vis, if you've got an electrode recording the wavefront on this side of it, on the left side, you will record a negative potential. Supposing you're recording it from middle, so you'll initially it will be moving towards that, so it's going to be a positive, and then it's going to move away, so it's going to be a negative. So you have a positive followed by a negative. This is important to understand. So whenever you have the depolarization wavefront moving towards the recording electrode, it's going to be a positive deflection recorded. When it is moving away, it's going to be a negative deflection. Also, depending on the muscle mass, the total wavefront, the magnitude will depend on that. So you have a smaller electrogram when it is depolarizing the atrium. When it's depolarizing the ventricle, it's going to be much larger. Between the right ventricle and the left ventricle has a bigger mass. So you'll have a bigger wavefront when it is recording the depolarization of the ventricle, left ventricle, compared to the right ventricle. And also it's important, the vector of the recording electrode. Supposing as in this diagram again, if you come back, so if your the wavefront is moving in this direction and you are recording, your electrode is at this point and recording, so you're going to record a reasonably big deflection. But supposing your recording electrode is at an angle, so you will probably record a positive deflection of a lesser magnitude. And if you are totally at a right angle, so you're recording from this point, it will probably record a neutral deflection rather than up or down. So the angle also makes a difference for you to really understand the ECG at that point. So your total amplitude depends on the recording, from which side are you recording, which direction is the wavefront moving, and this will simplify a lot of things when we have to really understand why does the ECG behave or the recording behave in a particular way. So once we record from the surface of the body, what we get are these complexes, and there has to be a nomenclature for us to communicate universally. So we have the P, QRS and T segments. The P represents the atrial depolarization, which precedes the ventricular depolarization, which is represented by the QRS, and the T represents the repolarization of the ventricles. So the nomenclature, as I was telling you, in a QRS, that's where most of the confusion arises. What is a Q wave? Q wave is the initial negative deflection before any positive deflection. If you have an R wave and then you have a negative wave, it is not a Q wave. So it has to be an initial negative deflection as seen here. There's nothing positive before this, so you have a negative Q. R wave is the first positive deflection. So as you see here, after the Q wave, we have the R wave. But if there was no Q wave here, there was a clear cut positive, that would also qualify as a R wave. So the first positive deflection is the R wave. S wave is the first negative deflection after the positive wave, or after the R wave, the negative deflection will be an S wave. And then we have something called an R dash and an S dash. The second positive is called an R dash, and a second negative is called an S dash. And that'll come into play when we talk about bundle branch blocks. The last thing which you will not get everywhere is the when do we use a small letter and when do we use a large letter. When the amplitude is beyond a certain magnitude, we use a bigger. So if the deflection is large, we use a bigger alphabet. So if using a small r, it is usually means less than 5 millimeter deflection. Anything more than that is qualified as a large. So sometimes you will see a small r, s and a big r after that. So it means that the first R is smaller and the second is much bigger. So for you to quickly go through this and understand and revise for you. So what is this one? Here we have just a positive deflection as you see in the first complex. So it's an R wave here. But what about this? You've got an R, then you've got a little down but not negative, and an R dash. So this is a notched R, or it's an R R dash. If you look at the third complex, we've got a negative. So it'll be a Q followed by a positive R and an S. Look at the fourth one, this will be called a Q and an R, that's the end of it. Then we've got a Q and an R, same as before, except that the Q here is bigger, so used a bigger alphabet here, which means a pathological Q here. Next one, it's an R and an S. Next to that is a small R and an S. So I basically to make you understand how the terminology changes. So in the bottom graph, the third one is a small R, so it's an R, S and an R dash. So just for you to understand the nomenclature, this is important when it comes to interpreting ECGs. Next important thing for you to understand is the territory or the leads. What do they represent? So these are something which you can mug up or understand also. When we say there's an inferior wall MI, so you have to understand what are these inferior leads. If I ask you that you look for an R wave or a P wave is best seen in the right side leads, so you should know what leads we are talking about. For designation, inferior leads are 2, 3 AVF. In other words, that means these leads are looking at the heart from bottom of it. So anything which is moving towards down from head towards toe will be recorded as positive in the inferior leads. And anything which is moving away will be recorded as a negative. So inferior leads are from the bottom, they are 2, 3 AVF. I think you should just memorize them here. The lateral leads are 1 AVL, V5 and V6. So they are looking at the heart from the lateral side. So anything which is moving down and towards the left will be recorded as a positive on the lateral leads. And the right side leads, V1 and AVR are the right side leads. So these are important for you to remember, and quickly when I say, okay, we will get a positive deflection on the lateral leads, or we are talking about a lateral MI, then we have to say 1 AVL. Your mind should immediately go, we are talking about leads 1 AVL, V5, V6. So not to make it too complex, inferior leads are 2, 3 AVF, lateral leads are 1 AVL, V5 and V6, and right side leads are V1 and AVR. generation of the ECG is the next step before we go to analysis of an ECG. Sinoatrial node or the SA node has the pacemaker cells, which are specialized cells, and they have the phase 4 depolarization wave going on, which start decide the heart rate. So as the depolarization goes, starts from the sinoatrial node, which is on the right upper side, it's going to activate the or depolarize the atrium. So you've got depolarization wave front, which is going to travel downwards and towards the left, and the atrium will get depolarized. So as you see here, if you're recording anything from this side of the heart, which means to the right leads, it's going to go away from that. Is it right? So we are going to record anything from right side, it's going to be away, because this is the SA node here. The depolarization wavefront is going downward and to the left. So if you're recording it from the left side, lateral leads, it's going to record a positive. So what are the right leads? As I told you, V1 and AVR. So these two leads will record a negative deflection, as I told you here, because the depolarization wave front is moving away from these leads, and all other leads are going to record a positive P wave. So what is a P wave? It represents the atrial depolarization. The direction is downward and to the left. So we have a negative P wave in right sided leads, which are AVR and V1. V1 can have a mixed, which you call as a biphasic. So you can have an initial positive and a negative, because it is standing in between. The atrium is right underneath there. There has to be one P wave preceding each QRS complex in a normal sinus rhythm with normal conduction. And all P waves are usually similar in size, shape and position. As you see in these, we've got the normal P waves here, but we have abnormal looking P waves here, biphasic inverted P waves. That means it's coming from side different from the normal depolarization sinoatrial node. You getting my point? So if your normal depolarization is going down this way, but supposing we have activation starting from here, an abnormal ectopic arrhythmia, so it's going to depolarize the atrium in this. So in this case, the inferior lead will record a negative P wave. So that means what we call in something called a coronary sinus rhythm, which stands here, the depolarization is going from down to up. At this point, all I want to say is that if it is an abnormal looking P wave, that means it's not coming from the normal located sinus node. So in a normal ECG, just to concentrate on the P waves here, as I was trying to tell you, in AVR, you will have a negative P wave, and you can see it very well here that we have a negative P wave, and as well in the lead V1.
Yeah, excuse me, sir. Here I just want to clear one issue.
Sure.
Just after seeing this P wave, can we look at this generation of this sinus rhythm where it has been generated?
Yeah, so that's what I'm saying. If it is coming from the normal sinus node, it has to be negative in lead AVR and lead V1. Rest is going to be positive. Okay. But supposing you have an ectopic arrhythmia arising from the lateral or the left atrium,
yes,
it's going to move towards the right atrium.
Right.
So your AVR and V1 will record a
positive
P wave.
Instead of it is negative.
So on the ECG itself, we can have some clue whether this arrhythmia or this rhythm is coming from the left atrium or the right atrium. But all I have to say right this point is that you should be able to understand that this is not a normal sinus rhythm. Or is it a normal sinus rhythm?
Yes.
So because when we start interpreting an ECG, the first word we use is normal sinus rhythm, NSR. So, I mean, it should just not be that you start talking about an ECG as an NSR. You should look at it and say, yes, it is an NSR. Somebody asks you, no, why do you say NSR? Then you are lost. So you should be able to say, because we have upright P waves in all leads except for lead AVR and lead V1, which is following the normal depolarization pattern. So it's a normal sinus rhythm. So it helps you localizing the depolarization wavefront, or where is it arising from. As it goes down, after depolarizing the atrium, it engages the AV node, which is located on the lower side of the intraatrial septum in the right atrium itself. The AV node is the filter of the heart. So if the atria beat very fast, not all of them will get conducted to the ventricle. So there is a delay in the AV node, which filters very rapidly firing atrium. So you get a what you call as a PR segment. This is a flat segment because the conduction in the AV node is slow. So most of the PR segment, which is measured from the beginning of the P to the beginning of the QRS, is comprised by the slow conduction through the AV node. As we move down to the ventricle from the AV node, it goes down the bundle of his, which divides into the left bundle and the right bundle, and through the specialized conduction system, the left fascicle, right fascicle, down to the Purkinje fibers and then to the muscle. So this is again a very rapid traveling wavefront which depolarizes and gives rise to a QRS, which is a simultaneously activation of the various chamber, various parts of the right and the left ventricle, which we will talk in the next few slides. But supposing the conduction is not through the specialized conduction at this point, we have partly conduction through these conductions and rest of them is conducted through the muscle, that part will become broad. Supposing you have a ventricle tachycardia arising from the muscle, it is going to activate muscle to muscle to muscle to muscle, which would mean a broad QRS. The width of the QRS is nothing but it is the duration over which the complete depolarization of the ventricle takes place. If it is slow, like if you give amiodarone, you see the complexes become very wide because the conduction is slowing down now. So it's taking that much longer. In patients who've got dilated hearts, you're going to have wider QRS because it's taking long time for the depolarization to take place. Coming back to the point, so the QRS complex is the next complex we have to talk about. It represents the ventricle depolarization. It starts from the beginning of the QRS as it leaves the baseline to the end of the QRS where the ST segment begins. The normal duration is less than 120 milliseconds, usually 80 to 100 milliseconds. Above 120 milliseconds is an abnormal QRS. How this QRS is formed is vital for you to understand. So if you look at these arrows, as we were talking, as the electrical wavefront moves down to the bundle of His, the first part of the ventricle, it's not the bundle of His which is getting recorded because the conduction is so brisk that it does not record anything on the ECG. It is the muscle which gets depolarized, which is being recorded as a QRS. So as it comes to the muscle, the first point to get depolarized is the septum. This is called septal depolarization, and the net resultant direction of this depolarization is from left to the right. This blue arrow here, this is very, very important that the first depolarization in the ventricles is from left to the right. All it means is here that if you are recording anything from the lateral part of the body or the lateral leads, you are going to have a negative initial deflection, which will mean a small Q wave here. So it's important that all ECGs in normal persons will have an initial small Q in 1, AVL, V5 and V6. Okay. On the contrary, on the right side leads, which are AVR and lead V1, we will have a small positive. So you'll have a small R to begin with in V1. So the initial deflection is from left to right, and then the right ventricle depolarizes. Along with that, the left ventricle depolarizes, but the left ventricle is bigger mass than the right ventricle. So your net deflection next takes place in the direction which is down and towards the left. As you can see here with my arrow, it's going to be down and towards the left. And the last portion of the ventricle to get activated is the postrobasal portion of the ventricle, which is again towards the left. So in other words, just to revise, if you see here, the diagrams on the top and the ECGs at this point here, but they are shown in lead 1 only here. So if you have the atrial depolarization, which is giving rise to the P wave, then we have the AV node, which gives rise to a fat flat PR segment, and then we have the ventricle depolarization. So you have a initial left to right, which means a little Q wave in lead 1, which is the lateral lead, and then we have the positive deflection, which is the depolarization towards the left, and then we have the last depolarization in the postrobasal segment. We have a little positive deflection again in the lateral leads, and then we have the repolarization, which is represented by the T waves as seen here. I hope this is clear, because just by understanding this, you can memorize. If I ask you what would be the normal QRS in lead V1, you should be able to tell me the normal is small r and a big S, because the initial deflection is towards it, and the next deflection, a bigger deflection, is away from it. Okay, so anything, if you say R in V1, if you say there's a big R in V1, it's abnormal. It cannot be normal now. Now by understanding this, you've clearly come to that conclusion for sure. and there is a list of causes of R in V1. That means you've got a dominant positive wave in V1, which is definitely abnormal. Okay, we'll come to all those. This is what a normal ECG looks like. We have, as I told you, a small R and a big S. So RS in V1, V2, the R starts getting bigger and the S becomes smaller, and we have something called a transition zone. So V3, V4 are called the transition zone, where a dominant negative turns around into a dominant positive. There is an importance of this transition zone also. V5, V6 will have predominantly a small negative and a big positive. So you have a QR complex in V5, V6, whereas a small R and a deep S complex in V1, V2. Okay, and the transition is V3 to V4. In VSTs, we have this complexes, what we call as equal complexes, R and S, right through the mid septal lead. So V2 to V5, all of them show similar complexes, and there's a phenomena which describes that, the KW phenomena in a VST, which is diagnostic. We can go back to your text and see that. This STT is the repolarization of the ventricles. It is a very important segment when we have to diagnose ischemia and related problems, myocardial infarction, and we'll talk about it.
I think Dr. Sardana has got done very good and important job, and he conclude this very difficult topic in a very fine way, and I think all of you must be benefited by his words of wisdom. And here I would like to end the session by saying thank you to all. Thank you very much.